Hey friends, and welcome back to my channel. If you are new here, welcome. My name is Wendy and I'm with Inspire Ministries. And as always, I am so glad that you have landed on today's video. Today, I want to tackle a very large topic, and that is prayer. Specifically, ways that you and I often hinder our own prayers. Things that we do that we may not even realize that we are doing that I believe separate us from the life-giving God. And so today I want to talk with you about five ways in particular that I believe that we are hindered in our prayer life. So if this is a video that interests you, let's just get right in. I remember when I first came across this concept of ways that we can hinder our own prayers and not even realize it. It was when I was reading through for another video that I did on a marriage series that I'm in the middle of doing right now, and it was in 1 Peter chapter 3. And I want to read to you what that verse was that led me on this rabbit trail of trying to figure out what are the ways that we often hinder our own prayers and we don't even realize. It. 1 Peter 3:7 says this, "In the same way, you husbands must give honor to your wives. Treat your wife with understanding as you live together. She may be weaker than you are, but she is your equal partner in God's gift of new life. Treat her as you should, so that your prayers will not be hindered." The Amplified adds this, "so that your prayers will not be hindered or ineffective." Is it possible for our prayers to be hindered or to be ineffective? I think so. And I want to talk to you today about several areas in Scripture. Now, I'm going to be all over, so you're going to want to get a pen and a notebook handy to write all of these down. But I believe that there are many scriptures that tell us that there are many, many ways that you and I, as believers, often hinder our own prayers. The first one that I want to take a look at is in the book of Isaiah. Isaiah 59, 1 through 2 says this, "Listen, the Lord's arm is not too weak to save you, nor is his ear too deaf to hear your call. It's your sins that have cut you off from God. Because of your sins, he is turned away and will not listen anymore." Oh, how I think that we are seeing this lived out in our modern day world. I believe that we are seeing in times that we are living in right now, where we are seeing God's hand being slowly but surely removed from this nation, from this world. So the first way that I believe that our prayers are hindered is by sin. Unrepented sin, unconfessed sin. I would say sin that no longer shocks us or hurts us or makes us feel bad or shameful. Sin that no longer causes us to repent or have any need at all to repent. Proverbs 10, 23 through 24 in the Amplified Bible says this, "Engaging in evil is like a sport to the fool who refuses wisdom and chases sin. But to a man of understanding, skillful and godly, wisdom brings joy. What the wicked fears will come upon him, but the desires of the righteous for the blessings of God will be granted." It is the desire of the righteous. So we have to ask ourselves, are we living righteously? Are we living pure and righteous lives as God wishes that we would? Now, of course, that doesn't mean that God doesn't hear the heart that is truly repentant, those who have sin to repent of and they repent. Because Psalm 106 verse 44 says this, "Even so, he pitied them in their distress and listen to their cries." So this doesn't mean that if you are living in sin and you come to full repentance because you realize and recognize God's sacrifice sacrifice for you and Jesus' death on a cross for you, it doesn't mean that he will not hear that. It means that he will not hear unrepented sin. When you continue in your sin, when you live wrong and you know better and you keep living unwise. Now take a look at Mark 11, verses 25 through 26 in the NLT. It says this, "But when you are praying, first forgive anyone you are holding a grudge against, so that your Father in heaven will forgive your sins too. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father in heaven forgive your trespasses." So the second way that I believe our prayers are hindered is by blatant unforgiveness. Forgiveness is hard. I understand that it is. It's hard for me too. It is very difficult, and it will always feel uncomfortable, and at times it will seem almost impossible, but it's the way that we look most like Jesus, and we must learn to exhibit it in our lives if we desire a right relationship with God and a desire to have his listening ear. Look at Matthew 5, 23 through 24 in the NLT. It says this, "So if you are presenting a sacrifice at the altar in the temple, and you suddenly remember that someone has something against you, leave your sacrifice there at the altar, go and be reconciled to that person, then come and offer your sacrifice to God." Now, some scriptures say, right, that when we need to forgive other people, then we need to abandon our sacrifice. But this one is clear that it says that if you are sacrificing, in other words, if you are offering up a prayer of petition, if you are offering up this sacrifice on the altar to God, and suddenly you remember that someone has something against you, someone is holding something against you, somebody is mad at you about something that maybe you've done or haven't done, or maybe there is some unforgiveness that somebody is harboring against you, he says, leave your sacrifice there at the altar, go and be reconciled to that person, then come back and offer your sacrifice to God. Be reconciled. That word reconciled means this. Listen to what the dictionary explains this word to mean. It means to accept or be resigned to something not desired. Wow. To accept or to be resigned to something not desired. To win over to friendliness, cause to become amicable, to compose or settle, to bring into agreement or harmony. So I think that that is a great way that we can look at how our prayers are oftentimes being hindered, and that is through blatant unforgiveness. Let's take a look at it in the Message paraphrase, because I love the way it says this. This is how I want you to conduct yourself in the matter. If you enter your place of worship, and you're about ready to make an offering, and suddenly you remember a grudge a friend has against you, not even that you have something against someone else, but that they might have something against you, to bring shame onto you, to bring yourself in a place of being hindered in your prayers, then abandon your offering, the Message version says, leave immediately, go to this friend and make things right. Then and only then come back and work things out with God. If he has something against you. So that means when I am praying and I think, oh man, I might have hurt that person, or I might have said something bad about that person, or maybe that person has a grudge that they are holding against me. Go, leave your sacrifice. Don't even attempt to try to offer it to God, because your prayer will be hindered. Go be reconciled to that person. Offer forgiveness. Say that you're sorry. Do something to be reconciled, even when you don't feel like doing it, because that's a real sacrifice, right? It's the only time we get the opportunity to give a sacrifice this way. It's this side of heaven when we're still living in this sin-filled place. Go back to the person, be reconciled, then come back, then present your offering or your prayer to God, and then make things right with him. I love this. Now let's take a look at 1 Peter 4, verse 7. Peter tells us this. He says, "The end of all things is near. Therefore, be alert and of sober mind so that you may pray." So that you may pray. Why? Because the end of all things is near. So be alert, be sober-minded. That way you can pray. Be alert. Be of sober mind. Other versions say it this way, earnest and disciplined, out of the NLT. Be serious and watchful is the New King James. The Good News translation says it like this, the end of all things is near. You must be self-controlled and alert in order to be able to pray. In the Aramaic plain text, it says this, therefore sober up and wake up to prayer. I love this. So you and I need to be awake. We need to be earnest and disciplined. We need to be serious and watchful. We need to be diligent in our prayers, and we need to be self-controlled so that our prayers can be answered. I think about being self-controlled, and I think so many times, so many religions talk so much about feelings. Like, right, we put so much emphasis on, I was feeling the Lord. I was feeling the Spirit of the Lord. But the truth of the matter is we can't wait for a feeling in order to be alert and sober-minded and self-controlled. We need to be self-controlled. We need to know that we need this right relationship with God, that we have a need for our prayers to be answered, that we have this need for this open dialogue and this open communication with the Savior of the world. And so it's important that we are self-controlled in our living every day. The third thing that I believe that hinders our prayers is not being self-controlled and calm. The Bible many times calls Christians to be meek and to have a quiet spirit. Ecclesiastes 10:4 says this, if a ruler's anger rises against you, some versions say if your boss is angry with you, do not leave your post. Calmness can lay great offenses to rest. Calmness, the way that you and I enter all of situations ought to be with meekness, with quietness, and with a calm spirit. Being meek is something that we don't talk about much in our modern day. It's a word that kind of has been lost in translation, but it involves three specific things. One, being calm in calamities. That means when there is crisis going around, we're calm. When there is turmoil going around, we are calm. I remember when my grandbaby had an emergency recently in the last couple months where they had to call, my daughter and my son-in-law had to call an ambulance to come get him because he wasn't breathing correctly. And it was a very scary time. And I remember having so much fear in that moment and reminding myself that God demands from those who belong to him a calmness and a spirit of meekness, of being calm, of being quiet, of being still, and of being of sober mindedness. And so I kept saying on repeat over and over again, okay, okay. And I would return myself to that place of being calm, even though I was filled with fear, even though I was filled with anxiety and dread and worry, I kept bringing myself back to that place of calmness, to that place of peace where I had to actually talk myself into being meek, being quiet, and being calm in the midst of calamities. So I think it involves three things. Again, being calm in calamities. Number two, maintaining a moderation of anger. I think that's huge. I think that when we come in our prayer time with any kind of anger, with any kind of hostility, with any kind of bitterness or rage towards other people, we need to check ourselves. And this is a great way that prayers are often hindered, is by this anger that we carry around. And number three, a sincere desire for harmony and a disposition to cultivate peace. These are the three things that I believe that having a meek spirit involves. So take a look at how these types of attitudes preclude the involvement of God on our behalf. I think it really matters. How is your anger? How are you staying calm in calamities? And how is your desire for harmony and peace the central key component of your life every day? I think it's wise. I think that we need to think about these things. Now back to 1 Peter 3:7 and talking about the necessity for husbands to treat their wives as God intended so that their prayers would not be hindered in any way. Charles Spurgeon says this, he suggests this, that we must take care to represent such persons in the most favorable light. Can you even imagine? What if our prayers were always aimed at keeping peace, of maintaining unity within our home, of choosing to see the best in other people? Can we say that? Can we say always that when we pray for somebody, somebody that's hurt us, somebody that we don't necessarily agree with, somebody who has harmed us or a family member, how often do we actually pray because the betterment of that person is our aim, is our key central component to why we're praying for that person? Can you imagine? I love this. We must take care to represent persons in the most favorable light. So can we say, God, I know you have plans for this person. And yes, I don't agree with them. And yes, they're speaking ill of me. And yes, they're causing turmoil. And yes, they're creating chaos. But I pray for the best for them. I know that you have great plans for them. I know that your heart for them is that you love them and that you died for them. And so, God, I'm praying for that person that I would be able to see them in the best light as possible is being renewed. It's being transformed by the renewing of our minds. I love this. I can't even imagine a world where if our prayers were for the betterment of other people, how much our world would change and how better our lives would look. What about being lukewarm in your faith? It's where, sadly, I think a majority of Christians live. And I'm just being honest with you. I think that a majority of Christians, self-proclaiming Christians, live in this perpetual season of lukewarmness more than what they'd like to admit. In talking to the church that was described as the uncommitted church in Laodicea, Jesus says this in Revelation 3:16, "But since you are like lukewarm water, neither hot nor cold, I will spit you out of my mouth." So I believe the fourth thing that certainly hinders our prayers is being in a state of being lukewarm. It's not deciding that God is going to be your end-all be-all. It's having one foot in the world and the other in the kingdom. It's living uncommitted and it's living a life of compromise. I think that that is really something that we have to keep continually going over. God, don't let me be lukewarm. One of the prayers that I pray all of the time is, God, don't let me fall away. God, I'm seeing all of these people fall away from their faith. I'm seeing all of these people compromise by the way that they're living and they're living lukewarm lives. God, don't let me fall into the trap of becoming lukewarm. I think we have to pray that all of the time. Colossians 3:8 says this in the English Standard Version, "But now you must put away all anger, wrath, malice, slander, and obscene talk from your mouth." Having a bad temper is what I believe is the fifth thing that can hinder our prayers. And oh, how I think that we see this more than any other thing that we've even talked about today. Having a bad temperament or a bad attitude. We hold grudges and are filled with entitlement and bitterness. How on earth do we expect that God is going to hear the petitions coming from a place of a vengeful and hate-filled heart? Charles Spurgeon says this, "There must be a holy living in a believer if his prayers are greatly to succeed with God. If you do not do Christ's will, he will not do your will." Wow, that is a scary concept. If we don't do his will, If we don't act the way that He wants us to act, behave the way that He wants us to behave, pray the way that He wants us to pray, He will certainly not do our will. His ears will be closed to our petitions. Finally, as we wrap up, let's take a look at John chapter 9, verse 31. It says this: "We know that God doesn't listen to sinners, but He is ready to hear those who worship Him and do His will." When we love our sin, when we offer up prayers in mockery, when we are disobedient or we are indifferent to God in any way, these are the things that stand to reason that God will not listen to our prayers. Psalm 66, verse 18, in the Amplified Version, it says this: "If I regard sin and baseness in my heart, that is, if I know it is there and I do nothing about it, the Lord will not hear me." If I know that sin is there, if I know that I have baseness and sin in my heart, I know it's there and I refuse to do anything about it, the Lord will not hear me. Listen, I cannot imagine a worse reality for myself than God not to hear me. It is like having Jesus say those dreadful words, "I did not know you." Another commentary that I read when I was studying for this is Jeremy Taylor, and he says this: "If we be not good men, our prayers will do us no good. God turns away from the unwholesome breathings of corruption." The unwholesome breathings of corruption. That means before it even is formed as a thought, before it's even formed as words, before it is even sin, when it's still resting as sin within the heart, that's still sin. And we know better. And if we know better and we still go on sinning, God will not listen to our prayers, because He will not be associated with corruption of any kind. In order for us to have a prayer life, I believe, that is honorable to God, we must maintain these five things. We must maintain self-distrust, not relying on ourselves at all, distrusting ourselves. Even Paul says, "I don't even trust myself at this point." And he was the greatest apostle of all time. "I don't even trust myself." Listen, the world puts so much emphasis on self-trust, believing in yourself, going with your gut, doing the best you can. Listen, the scripture is anti all of these things. We must leave ourselves at the altar and live maintaining every day this level of self-distrust. The next thing we must have is confidence in God. That's number two. Number three is humility. God loves and He honors a humble heart. And it takes a lot of prayer to have a humble heart, to say, "You know what? They might not agree with me, but I'm doing this anyway because it honors God. I am going to let go of anger. I'm going to let go of revenge. I'm going to let go of my right to get even, and I'm going to live with humility because that's how God demands that I come to Him." I believe that's number three. The fourth way that I believe that we live a life, a prayer life that is honorable to God, is having reverence towards Him. And I say this all of the time. One of the things that we have lost as Christian people, as Jesus people, is the reverence and the awe of God. And I believe that that is so important for us to have. And then number five is submission to God's will. So we have self-distrust, confidence in God, humility, reverence, and submission to God's will. Listen, God will not hear these four prayers. I believe these four prayers. God will not hear the prayers apart from the mediation of Jesus. 1 Timothy 2:5 says, "For there is one God and one mediator who can reconcile God and humanity, and it's the man of Jesus Christ." Number two is, I believe that God will not hear the prayers of those that are wicked and who hold this formal and heartless way that they are praying. Proverbs 15:29 says, "The Lord is far from the wicked, but He hears the prayers of the righteous." Number three, I believe that God will not hear the prayers of those who continue in their sin, like we've been talking about, and abide in unbelief. Take a look at Isaiah 1:15. It says, "When you lift up your hands in prayer, I will not look. Though you offer many prayers, I will not listen, for your hands are covered with the blood of innocent victims. Here, God is charged the people with perverting his laws in order to practice violent injustice towards innocent victims. Sounds a lot like abortion, doesn't it? He will not hear those prayers. Why? Because they are perverting the law. They're living with self in mind only. They are people who are practicing injustice done to innocent lives. And then number four, God will not hear the prayers of those who refuse to hear his word or regard his laws and his truths. Proverbs 28:9 says, if anyone turns a deaf ear to my instruction, even their prayers are detestable. So when you turn around, when you turn a deaf ear on the instruction of the Lord, in other words, you've read what you need to do and you do the exact opposite when you refuse to do what the law requires, what this book says to do, even our prayers will be not just unanswered, but detestable. He cannot hear those who don't speak to him. He can never hear those who never talk to him. So friend, I urge you to talk to him, to give yourself to him wholly and completely, to pray. If you do not have a heart to pray now, that you would pray actually that God would give you a more sensitive heart to his spirit. God cannot hear those who never speak to him. Another truth is he has never given up, not one time on us. He's never giving us a flat refusal. It's always on us. We are always the one that walks away on him. He's never the one that gives a flat refusal to you and I. And the next truth is that he always permits us to pray. He always gives us permission to come to him. When Jesus died on the cross, the veil was torn. And what that means is there was no longer substance between us and God. We had the veil removed, which means we can at all times come to God in prayer. We are permitted to the feet of Jesus every day of our life. Friend, I hope that these hindrances of prayer have helped you to see some ways that you might be causing there to be a separation between you and God and you don't even realize it. I know that my own eyes were opened. When I was studying through these, my eyes were opened to these great truths and to these great ways that I know that I have been guilty of in the past, of hindering my own prayers and not even realizing it. Friend, I hope that you have liked this video. If you have, would you give it a huge thumbs up? Would you subscribe to this channel? Become a part of this family? I love to hear from you. So drop me a comment in the comment section down below. Let me know that you are here. Let me know what things that you struggle with and let me know what videos that you would like to see in the future. Would you also hit that notification bell to be notified for every time that I upload content just like this one? Until my next video, friends, I'm praying for you. I'm praying for you because I know these truths are hard. They're not easy. They're challenging, but the Word of God generally is challenging. Following God is challenging, but it's always, always worth it. I pray, friend, that you today have an awesome day with Jesus. Keep getting in his word. Keep trusting him. Keep clinging to him and pray these hindrances of prayer would be completely done away in your life. I love you, friend, and I will see you next time. Bye-bye.